The Quran was sent to mankind to guide us all the way to the day, the day where we'll be asked what we did in our life to make it that way. So we need to be ready and prepared.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. نحمده ونستعين ونستغفر ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Dear brothers and sisters, you are watching Huda and this is Sunnah Style, an amazing episode, an amazing topic. Inshallah, today we'll talk about Hollywood culture and Medina culture. And for those who are just joining us, you might have not seen the first episode, the introduction. We are talking about the issues that concern Muslims today, specifically the Muslim youth. What are some of the issues that are being pushed aside and not addressed by our ummah? What are some of the issues that are causing the ummah to split? Okay, the elder generations who are practicing praying and so on, and the younger generations who are faced with so many questions, who are faced with an identity crisis. Who am I? So much confusion. Who am I supposed to be? Am I American? Am I Muslim first? Which one comes first? Am I this? Am I that? So this show is specifically designed for this, addressing those things. And as I have said, I've created some posts on Facebook, and you can type it and search Gabriel Al-Romaani, okay? Al-Romaani. And you can follow some of the questions, amazing questions that have been posted by Muslims. Normal Muslims, okay, this is not a show of a sheikh or someone talking just down upon us. And I want to make, again, disclaimers, okay, because a lot of people might misunderstand it. What are you telling us, that this is wrong, or we shouldn't go to the sheikh, or we shouldn't do this? No, that's not what we are saying. And I'm making a disclaimer, not to be misunderstood. What I'm saying is that we need to put everything in perspective and to take the benefit, okay, from all sides, and to know where and what, how and when. Okay, this is something very important. Now, I want to connect again a little bit with you and tell you a little bit more about myself, because I want to, as I said, this is a lot has to do with what I've experienced, with people that I've talked to, a lot of things that I have faced in my youth. And I found that there's a pattern that a lot of people are facing the same issues. A lot of you might be sitting there in front of the TV and having big issues, and you have no one to turn to, no one to talk to about. So I want to say, you know, first and foremost, as I said, I am a revert to Islam. I have become a Muslim, you know, when I was about approximately 20 years of age, in my first year of university, and I was faced with many issues at that time. And when I became Muslim, many issues came after it. Okay, a lot of questions navigating through Islam, dealing with, you know, facing my own culture, my own preconceptions and beliefs, and trying to have this, as I would call it, like a war, a spiritual war even, trying to submit to the deen and to understand this beautiful way of life, which is called Islam. Alhamdulillah, I'm a teacher by profession, alhamdulillah, and also I have graduated from psychology, okay, I've studied psychology, and this has helped me to study and to be able to understand the thinking of people, and especially the youth. It had helped me a lot to do a lot of introspection. Introspection, what it means that you actually think about your thoughts, you analyze yourself. What do you feel and why, and what are the causes, and what can be some of the changes that you can do? You have to understand that the mind is so powerful. The human mind is very powerful. The human mind can make the body sick. The human mind can have influences on so many, you know, aspects of our existence. So this is very important. At the same time, the heart has so much influence on the rest of the body. And we will talk about the two, because there's a connection between the spiritual and between the physical world. Okay, and Islam joins the two in a perfect way. طيب. At the same time, alhamdulillah, I've been blessed to study Islam, and I'm a student of some of the shuyukh and the scholars that you see on this very channel, on Huda TV. And alhamdulillah, I'm studying in the Mishka University, or what used to be the Sharia Academy. Alhamdulillah, it's a big blessing. I've learned so much, and it's helped me so much to understand and to see life from the Islamic perspective. Alhamdulillah, and it's a blessing. I would encourage everyone to follow and to look for a path. And inshallah, in one of the episodes, we will talk about the importance of seeking knowledge and how and where and what to do as a youth and how can I gain knowledge in Islam and how can I apply this knowledge in today's context. Okay, how can I use Islam to understand what is happening in the world and the issues that I'm dealing with my friends and so on. So this episode is called Hollywood Culture versus Medina Culture. Yes, that's right. Hollywood versus Medina. Now, Hollywood is, I'm sure it's very, 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 very well known. Everyone knows Hollywood, the movies, the things that are produced, all the video clips, and so many things that people are following. I mean, all the way from the West to the East, I would doubt if there would be many people who do not know what is Hollywood. And it's amazing, because a lot of the figures that are, you know, featured in Hollywood can be seen as very famous in many places. And I was, subhanAllah, in Africa. I had the chance to be in Africa not too long ago. And we were literally on the mountains, okay? And you were driving and you're looking around, you're looking at different, you know, stores and places, and you'll find a concept that is so widespread and that is, of course, very popular through the media. It's been pushed and talked about, and today has been taken as a form of art, and that is graffiti. Okay, you'll find on the mountains of Tanzania, in the mountains of Tanzania, different buildings with graffiti on it, okay, and featuring different actors and singers that are featured in Hollywood, right? So you would say, subhanAllah, and how did these people arrive there? They're so well known. That is because of this culture, this Hollywood culture. Now, let us take a few steps back and ask us the question, how does culture and how do surroundings affect our upbringing, the way we think, the way we are, the way we speak, the way we deal with each other, what we do, how we do? And just because we find ourselves following a certain trend, and this is, I want the youth to think very rationally. Okay, it can be a debate, it can be anything you want to show, but I want you to think rationally. If you find you follow something, does that mean that this thing is correct or that it is true? If you follow a certain culture, a certain trend, a certain rap musician or a gang or a way of, you know, style that you think that is correct, be it emo or be it, you know, gangster rapper or being pop culture or being whatever, you know, different group it might be, is this correct or is it true? Now, what is culture anyway? A lot of people might, you know, what is this culture? Why we always hear about pop culture, rock culture, Hollywood culture. What is culture? Cultures are defined as trends, okay? In very simple terms, things that people do, things that people in a place or in an area, you know, find acceptable. They find it popular. They find it that, you know, this is the thing to do. All right, this is the cool thing that everyone is doing. Everyone is fine with it. We accept it. This is our way, the way we do it. In some places, it might be that you drive in the middle of the road. In some places, it might be that you drive slow, they drive fast. In some places, it might be that you spit on the street, right? But again, we ask ourselves, just because people have accepted it in general, is this something that is correct or not? Cultures can be cultures of work, cultures that can be in schools. I mean, it can go even within a certain country. There can be so many different cultures, right? So again, we need to ask ourselves this very important question. If you're just joining us, you are watching Sunnah Style on Huda. You have to ask yourself this very important question. If I'm following what I'm following, whatever it might be, look at your clothes, look at what you're thinking, look at what you're saying, how you're speaking. Is it correct? And is it true? Another thing that links to culture is identity, okay? And the question of who am I? What defines me? If I were to ask you right now, or if someone would come and say to you, who are you? Okay? A lot of people might just give their names. I am Mahmoud. I am, you know, Joe. I am G. and so on, right? So they'll kind of give their name. But I'm asking, who are you? Okay, you should have quite a long list of things that you could define yourself, or it should be something very simple that has, you know, deeper points within it. As for myself, when someone asks me, I say I'm a Muslim, okay, because Islam covers so many things, culture, identity, and many, many things in between, right? So everyone has to have an identity, okay? From a psychological standpoint, people have to have an ID. Okay, who are you? Now, when we look around ourselves, when we look around on the street and so on and so forth, there can be a big debate that can start, okay, as to any the Muslim specifically. Well, should I dress a certain way? Should I write on myself that, hey, by the way, I'm a Muslim, you know, I'm a Muslim. Hello, hello, I'm a Muslim. Or is it just to have it in the heart? And, you know, I'm a Muslim, I pray, but, you know, I kind of mind my own thing within the comfort of my own home, and I'll do my things, and, you know, I'm not going to impose, or people should not know. This is my business, okay? It's my business, no one else's business. You know, mind your own business, right? Everyone has to have an ID. Okay? If you're a Muslim, if you say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, you should have a Muslim identity, okay? If you are a Canadian, an American, an Egyptian, whatever you are, an African, and you're a Muslim, you should first and foremost say that you are a Muslim. I am a Muslim African. I am a Muslim Canadian. I'm a Muslim Romanian. But the first thing is that I am a Muslim. Okay, fine. Now, if you say that, how do you express it? How does that reflect? Okay. And now I want you to be very careful and not misunderstand, because you might take the wrong idea and picture. You should act like a Muslim. Okay? You should educate yourself and know what does Islam teach us with when it comes to act, you know, how you should act, your behavior, your manners, how you speak, what you speak. You've seen how I started, alhamdulillah, the show. This is a way that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to start speaking when he used to give sometimes some of his khutbahs, right? This is the way that he used to do. Not always, but this is the way he used to do. And this is sometimes, you know, it's part of the sunnah, right? The way you look at people, okay, the way you smile. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in his sunnah, تَبَسَّمُكَ فِي وَجْهِ أَخِيكَ صَدَقَ, that your smile in the face of your brother, it is a sadaqah. Or كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, or how the Prophet ﷺ said. So, how you dress? Now people might say, well, hold on a second. Does it matter how I dress? Like, I like to, you know, to be cool, like in line with everyone. I like to be, you know, hip and hop. There is a big debate here. Because if you're a Muslim, you should look like a Muslim. Now someone say, wait a second. Are you telling me I have to dress like Saudi Arabia? Are you telling me I have to dress like what I see on TV? Are you telling me I should look like, you know, what CNN shows me about Muslims? I'm not telling you that you should do this or you should that it is fard or something like that. But now, rationally speaking, think about it. How do you dress? How do you look like? Do you look like a Muslim, like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like how he was described? Are you close to looking like that? Or do you look like you know, a model, or do you look like Kobe Bryant, or do you look like David Beckham? Now, a lot of people say, wait a second, what are you talking about? You know, I'm not comfortable with this, because are you telling me that I have to look like my uncle and my father and my grandfather, and I should, you know, my friends will make fun of me. How can I go and be with my friends on the block, you know, on the corner of the street, because they're going to make fun of me, you know, if I look like this? I'm not saying that. But inshallah, we're going to take a break and we'll be back here on Huda with Sunnah Style. We'll address this very important question. Get your friends, get your family, watch Huda TV. Assalamu alaikum.
What we did in our life to make it that way. So we need to be ready and prepared.
Only if we knew Allah, we would truly worship Him.
How can you worship someone you don't even know?
We would love Him, fear Him, and have hope in His mercy.
Wallahi, Wallahi, wallahi. And I challenge anyone in the earth, anyone in the world, to tell me one time in their life that they took the means and they put their trust in Allah and Allah let them down.
Only if you knew with Majid Mahmood in Ramadan, only on Huda TV.
Didn't have to make it their way, so we need to be ready and prepared.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Welcome back. You're watching Huda TV, and this is Sunnah Style. If you're just joining us, amazing new show, amazing episode, Hollywood culture versus Medina culture. Amazing title, right? I'm sure I caught your attention. Before we broke, we spoke a little bit. We touched upon a debate. Okay, how should I look as a Muslim? The way I talk, the way I behave, should it reflect Islam? Should people, when they look at me, know that, you know, this is a Muslim? I think this is a Muslim. And a lot of people I have issues with here, and it's fine. You know, again, this is nothing that's written in stone. I'm giving you here some reasonable explanations, and if you want to debate it, alhamdulillah, this is a good, healthy discussion that we are having here on Huda TV, touching upon the youth, bringing the youth together. Let's dialogue, let's debate. We're going to bring up some questions from Facebook, some of the posts that the people have posted. And you might ask yourself, well, wait a second, Jibril. Should I wear this bandana funny thing that you're wearing on your head? Should I have this long thobe? What about this thing that you're wearing on top of you, this little sweater? I mean, it kind of looks like very modern, you know? Like, what are you doing? You're like mixing the two in your shoes and you got a Mac laptop. What's going on, right? So, again, let's reasonably and rationally approach this issue. Well, should you look like a Muslim? Yes, you should look like a Muslim. Okay, and there are many ways that you can look like a Muslim. It can be from the way you dress, your beard, for the sisters, the hijab. It can be, and of course, the way you behave and so on. These, you cannot separate the two, because a lot of times, and we will talk about more about this, a lot of times people will say, well, you know, people will look Muslim, but they don't behave Muslim. You know, I behave Muslim, I don't look Muslim. I don't think looks are that important. This is a wrong thinking, okay? Islam brings the two together. You have to have a Muslim identity, look like a Muslim, and you should behave like a Muslim. This is without a doubt. A lot of times sisters say, you know, the hijab is in my heart. You know, I'm okay with it. I'm such a good person. I don't have to cover my hair. No, this is a wrong understanding, okay? Have the nice hijab in your heart, and also you should cover yourself and follow the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Type. So what is this? Yani, because we find in the hayat al-sahaba, the lives of the sahaba, that when they used to move to a different place, that they would accommodate the clothing of the people of that area. Right, a lot of Muslims today are living in America, Canada, England, all over the place in non-Muslim countries, and they're wearing some of the clothing that the people wear. Of course, no one can say that this is haram. Okay, no one can make a cut down statement and say, oh no, this is haram. You are imitating the kuffar. Okay, this is not in that point. Okay, when it comes to imitating the kuffar, it comes to things that will be religiously, things that are identified with these people, with the kuffar, or so on and so forth. And that's when it comes to it. But there is a limit, because things that are against Islam, it can be a dress that is against Islam. Okay, it's too tight. It shows the body, for example, for a woman, for a sister. It shows her shapes. This is not allowed. She could be covering herself with a certain different, you know, thing that might be of the people who live there. It might be something that, you know, is in style or so on and so forth. But, you know, but it covers the body in such a way that it does not show the shape, that it respects the Sharia requirements, that it covers the parts of the body that are supposed to be covered. No one is saying that you have to dress like this country or that country or so on and so forth. But you should understand and know that the Sharia has outlined certain things when it comes to how loose the clothing are, how long the clothing are, and certain things that they're not attractive and they don't catch up the eye and so on and so forth. These, we should inform ourselves as youth, as Muslims, if you want to follow the true way, the Sunnah way of Prophet Muhammad and the way that is in line with the Sharia. That way, at the same time, you'll be recognized as a Muslim. When you play football, soccer, whatever you might call it, wherever you're from, Do you go and start wearing, you know, everyone's wearing, you know, that your team is wearing red, another team is wearing white, and you're going to wear green, and you're part of the red team? It doesn't make sense, right? People will not recognize, who are you? Or are you going to wear black like the referee, and people are going to mistake you for the referee? Then I'm going to pass you the ball. It's not like that, rationally speaking, right? We need to identify ourselves as Muslims. And we need to feel proud of that. We need to feel good about that. We need to feel happy about that. Wait, are you telling me that I cannot wear jeans or something if I'm a man or something like that? No one's saying that. You can wear jeans. But at the same time, you should be careful about the way the jeans are and so on and so forth, that you respect the Islamic requirements. If you want to wear a thobe, if you want to wear this, this is good, mashallah. Okay, because there's culture that is identified as Islam, right? When you wear look at someone who is wearing a thobe or jalabiya, whatever you want to call it, you will say that, I think this is a Muslim. Now, there might be people saying, well, wait a second, there's some Christians who wear thobes and so on. Yes, I've seen them. There are in my country and many countries. This is not an issue, okay? This is a cultural dress. But most likely, people identify you as a Muslim. Now, if you want to do that, alhamdulillah, that is good. On the sister side now, when we look at it, we will see that there's, and I really want to address this question because it has been posted on Facebook and is an amazing question. Sisters, of course, within Islam, they have to wear the hijab, right? They are the ones who are really representing the deen, right? There's almost no case of mistaken identity when you look at a Muslim sister who is practicing. You see her wearing her hijab, and you say, you know what, this is a Muslim woman. And subhanAllah, many times they suffered because of that, because ignorant people have done things to them or have said things to them because they identified them as Muslims. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them because they represented Islam. They're representing this deen. You know what I'm saying? So, but the question has been asked about the sisters that, you know what, brother? We wear the hijab. We sometimes get insulted living in the non-Muslim countries and so on and so forth because people look at us and they say, oh, she's a Muslim. Let me say something to her. Let me say something based on what some people do and what I see on TV. This way, somehow, I'm going to do something good for my country or something like that. And it's something very ignorant. Right? So the sisters have asked, that's, you know, we are doing this. We're taking this for the deen. Inshallah, may Allah bless them. But what about the brothers? Okay? How come when sometimes you look at a brother and you don't know if is he Muslim? Is he not? What's going on? Where is he? So, Why the disconnection? Why the contradiction? Why do we push? Or sometimes, you know, our women should be like this or should like this. But when it comes to the brothers, it's just, you know, too loose. Should we look like Muslims? Yes, we should. Is there leniency and is there some kind of leeway of how and what you can wear? Yes, there is. Of course, alhamdulillah. But we should. This is something very important, that we should identify ourselves as a Muslim. Okay, people should, at least when they kind of glance at us or look at us, say that I think he's a Muslim. And of course, after they talk to us and they interact with us, it should confirm that they are Muslims by the good behavior and by the way that they deal. Okay, this is something very important. A lot of times, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he guide our youth, going back to this question, sisters are angry because they say, you know what, my husband or my brother, he's wearing shorts, they're not even covering his awrah, they're not even properly, you know, and he's all, you know, and I have to, you know, I'm covering myself, and why this, you know? The problem is not with Islam, sister. The problem is not with you, sister. The problem is with the brother who doesn't understand the proper requirements of covering himself. So alhamdulillah, sisters are really representing the Medina culture, the Muslim culture. Now this brings me back to a very, very important point that people need to understand. Culture Islam versus Islamic culture. Because a lot of times, people are pushed away from the Medina culture, and why this name is the Sunnah, the way the Prophet ﷺ brought up the Sahabas to be, to act, to dress, to interact with each other. Culture Islam versus Islamic culture. Two very different things. Culture Islam is, you know what, we've become Muslim, we're Muslim, and then we start adding things to the Islam. I'll do this, I'll do that, and we make it kind of, you know, mix it, make it part of Islam. It's funny because I'll just give you some, and I am not, again, insulting any culture, I am not picking on any culture, I'm not doing anything. A lot of times people say, you know, I am namazi, okay? This whole concept of, you know, I pray. I pray five times. They identify that and I pray. And you ask them, okay, and then what? Well, you know, this is it. I just pray and sit on my couch at home and do this, you know? Sometimes, subhanAllah, these type of cultural aspects are from ignorance, okay? SubhanAllah, some people in some cultures, they marry the Qur'an. For example, a woman will not get married because she says, you know what, I married the Qur'an. I'm married with the Qur'an. This is cultural Islam. This is against the real Islam, subhanAllah. In many cultures, for example, the issue of widows, you know, that they should not marry. It's kind of, you know, shameful that if you marry, and so on and so forth. Another thing, reading the Qur'an, when someone dies or on very special occasions, and then just leave it there and just keep it on the, you know, the top of the shelf, and that's it. You know, we're not gonna, you know, touch the Quran because it's just so holy, and that's it, right? Another thing is about not seeing, for example, your wife before you marry her. Just marry, never even seeing her first. You already married when you sit down with her, and then you look at her. What if you don't like it? You know. So these are just some examples I'm giving you here. A cultural Islam. And a lot of time this causes a big problem for the youth, okay? Some people might be second generation Arabs, second generation Pakistanis or something, living in the UK, living in Canada, living in the States, and they're like, they're looking at like, you know, I'm not down with what my pops do because, you know, I don't see this. I mean, what is he doing? You know, and some things are weird and I don't know, Sheikh so-and-so said this and I mean, and if I do that, he's going to tell me, you know, get out of my house and this is my way or the highway. And people are confused. You know, I should just stay away from it totally. Okay, this is hindering them from getting close to Islam. A lot of times they'll get the wrong concept of what Islam is. You know, there'll be no love, no emotions, no feeling. And they'll say, you know what, oh, I don't think I like this because the people that I live with, they're always talking about love, about compassion, kindness, being nice, you know, falling in love, being nice to your spouse and so on. And, you know, I see my father is just ordering my mom and she's just in the kitchen nonstop and that's it. And, you know, look at these people, they're talking about equality, gender equality. And you know what, I like this more, right? So this is, subhanAllah, culture Islam. Now, on the other side of the spectrum, we have Islamic culture. This is culture that has been taken from Islam. It's in line with Islam. Okay, this is culture that is very much an Islamic. And this is something that is very important because it can be on many levels. Okay, the way you dress, it can be so and so, but it falls in line with Islam. The way certain foods even, subhanAllah, Annie, that there's, you know, that you eat, that fall in line within Islam. That Islam, of course, accommodates the cultures and accommodates the different, you know, many differences. But there are some things that are against Islam. How you dress, as we just talked about it. A lot of times people disobey the Sharia because of their culture. No, in Islamic culture are things that are inspired from Islam. Of course, there are differences between the nations. And Islam has no issue with that, alhamdulillah. But we need to make sure that these culture, these issues that we are dealing with every day, they're part and parcel of our daily life, that these fall in line with what Islam allows. This is the very important thing, okay? So I'm asking the youth to please look at yourself. Look beyond the cultural Islam and look into the Islamic culture. Look into the truths of Islam and see the reality between the Hollywood culture and the Medina culture. Between culture that is not Islamic, actually against Islam, and the culture that is the Sunnah. Okay, there should be no disconnect. We should know the seerah. We should have different ways, alhamdulillah, and some things that are starting to portray and to bring this in the light for the youth that they understand. Be it shows like this, alhamdulillah, on Huda TV, Sunnah Style, and so on, or many, you know, different movies and so on that are in line with Islam and that are pushing this and are helping us to understand this. Thank you for watching this amazing episode of Sunnah Style. Inshallah, we will see you next time on Huda TV. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ooh, 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 ooh.
The Quran sent to mankind to guide us all the way to the day, the day where we'll be asked what we did in our life to make it that way. So we need to be ready and prepared.